Good day, everybody. Welcome to another Bosch Security Systems webinar. This time the topic is security-related design tools. Thank you all for joining. Your host today is Patrick Leumans, a head of business development application design team and also expert in access control systems, and myself, Szymon Klebowski. I'm a specialist in video systems. During our session today, I'm going to present you video systems design tools, which will be online lens calculator, BVMS checklist, IP video design tool, plus two extra PDFs. And Patrick will tell about access control product overview, BIS system design guide, BIS licensing guide, and BIS detector point calculator. So let me start with video design tools. The first tool is an online lens calculator. As the name says, it's an online web-based tool, so with this link, we're getting into the tool directly. It's a straightforward solution. So you need to select the proper camera you're going to have a calculation for. On the left-hand side, you see different camera families. So let me pick up one of the latest in our portfolio, Dinion IP3000IR. Then I have a different camera models. As you see, this is a 5 megapixel, this is full HD, so I'll take the full HD camera. This camera comes with an integrated lens, so let me use the maximum focal length it can offer. Target object. This is half a meter by 1.7 meter, which is typically a human size as specified in the video system standards. You can, of course, adjust it to your needs. And the camera installation height, okay, 4 meters. Let me put lower in this case, 3 meters. With that said, I calculate. Of course, I can also manually adjust the camera tilt angle. But I left it as it is. And as you can see, this is the result of my calculation. First of all, it tells me about the DORI criteria. DORI stands for Detection, Observation, Recognition, Identification, which are the criteria measured in pixels, I mean in pixels per meter density, as established by the European norm EN62676-4. This is currently applicable video systems application standard. Basically says that identification of a person takes place if we have 250 pixels per meter, the pixel density in the image. And with our calculator, we know, okay, it's gonna work up to 13 meters away. Then we have the following distances for the recognition, observation, detection. And the same is represented here with the side view and the top view in our calculator. So these are also, this is identification, the light blue, then a bit darker will be recognition, observation, detection. This camera comes also with infrared illuminator. And we see that, okay, this infrared illuminator with this installation height is going to provide illumination almost up to 30 meters away, which corresponds one-to-one with the datasheet information. But the most important is, of course, the video analytics, because this is our main tool to calculate if Bosch video analytics, either the essential video analytics or the intelligent video analytics in our cameras, would work. So now we know that in our case, it's going to work from 16.66 meters away up to 42 meters away, and most probably even farther. But as you see, we are limited with target height. So below that distance with this tilt angle, the target will be actually bigger than the field of view, and therefore potentially not detected. But if the target is smaller, for example, a box, then we have more we can extend this detection range by extra distance. Let me repeat the whole procedure with some other camera. So I'm going to take, for example, Pantil Zoom Autodome 5000 IIR. Just one type number. I'll take full HD resolution. And this camera, okay, it comes with much longer lens, so let me use its maximum focal length. Everything else the same. I calculate. And then you see that, okay, the identification goes almost up to 185 meters away, and detection almost 1,800, okay, almost precisely 1,833 meters away, which is almost 2 kilometers from the camera. Infrared illumination provided by the camera goes up to 150 meters away, sorry, up to 254 meters away with this installation height, and yeah, video analytics. My video analytics is going to work from 231 meters away up to 794 meters away. So this is a pretty easy, straightforward tool. I strongly recommend using it. It's the basic tool I use in my work. Let me come back to the presentation. So the second tool I wanted to present today is a BVMS checklist. I use it as a storage calculator. This tool you can download with this link from the web pages, but you know, let me, since I downloaded it already, let me start here. So this is the Excel file with numerous worksheets, as you can see here. The basic one is here, BVMS checklist. It comes with some explanatory. I mean, first of all, it comes in different colors. These colors have meaning, as you can see. So it's either mandatory, optional, or they give the result of what we provided with. Mostly, this tool is used for the Bosch Video Management System projects to verify if everything is calculated correctly. But as I said, I mostly most of the time I use it as a very reliable storage calculator. How to use it as a storage calculator? Like previously, you need to select the camera. So let me select the same camera we used in our lens online lens calculator example. Here I receive the information what the type number is and what is the product platform. The product platform can be actually important, so please note that. Then I select what resolutions I would like to use. I would like to use the maximum resolution with the maximum frame rate. Here I can apply the different encoding profiles. Each Bosch camera comes with 8 encoding profiles predefined. You can of course adjust them to every bit. But if you decide to use the profile as it comes from us, from the manufacturer, in this case, I apply the balanced quiet, meaning that I would like to have a balanced image quality, not too high, but not too low. And I expect there is going to be not much, actually quiet scene with not much traffic in there. Here I select the encoding standards, my recording stream, full HD, 25 frames per second. So is my live viewing stream. I'm putting let me zero that. So I'm putting 10 cameras in my let me make 15 cameras in my group. So I'm going to have 15 of these cameras. What I missed is this, okay. Because now I have 15 cameras and I have the automatic result because the system knows when I applied this product platform with H.265 encoding balance quiet profile, it means it's gonna on average most probably use 1,961 kilobits per second and uses this value for a storage estimation, which in our case at this time is almost 5 terabytes. So net storage requirement is 4.97 terabytes with a recorded bandwidth 30 megabits per second from all the cameras altogether. One more important factor here is sanity check and VRM downtime in days. If you don't really use the VRM system, I suggest keep it at one or even at zero. So it doesn't, I cannot do it. Zero, so keep it at one, so it does not really mess with your storage calculation. It has some meaning, but you know, it's a longer story. I skip it for some other time. So here's my result. Let me put then the other camera, which will be this Autodome 5000, which I use for our lens online lens calculator example. It's also same product platform. I also applied full HD resolution, but I applied a different profile. PTZ optimized, H.265, yeah, PTZ optimized, H.265 encoding, 30 frames per second in case of this camera is available. And as you see, my recording bandwidth is 2137 kilobits per second. Now I need to provide the number of the cameras. So let's say in my solution, I'm going to have five of these cameras. And this way, my recorded storage estimation grew over the 4 terabytes. What if I have a camera which is not the latest product and therefore not mentioned in this drop-down list? So you can select the option other Bosch or on with camera, and then you have a worksheet bitrate guide manual. This is basically allowing you to apply any of the profiles with any of encoding platforms, with any of the codecs and resolution. So let us say that I had a camera which was an elder camera, CPP3, and this camera was 720p resolution, and I expect that it was a busy scene where this camera is going to, which this camera is going to monitor. So I applied the balance busy conditions. I mean, again, balance, but this one time busy, not quiet, with 30 frames per second. And you see, okay, it tells me that with H.265 encoding, this resolution, this frame rate, busy scene, balance, image quality, it's gonna consume 5,340 kilobits per second. So, oops, here we are. So, here, 5,000, sorry. 5,300, what was it? 40. 40, here we are. And these cameras, I'm going to have also five. You see, the total bandwidth has risen to 70 mega, almost 70 megabits per second, and the total storage calculation did not change. Why? 25 cameras. Okay, I know why. Let's think. I need minimum retention time. Okay, so how many days I'm going to record? So I'm going to record everything 10 days at least. 15, 5, 5, 25 cameras, yes. Each of them recorded in, 10 days. Each of them should be also belonging to the same storage pool. Now we have a good result. So the total result would be 8.69 terabytes. One more important factor: if you don't buy the, if you make this calculation just, you know, not for the actual project where the Bosch products are applied, please use no in this line, as it actually offers extra redundant solution if you use yes and you don't want it to just know the storage estimation. Okay, that was briefly this tool. Next tool. This is the IP video design tool from JVSG. I put a small project up before, so this is how it looks like. This is the software. This is a very good software allowing you, for the graphical representation. It allows you, to place your cameras in on a two-dimensional plans and then have three-dimensional graphical representation how your camera is going to see and what. So it's very simple tool, takes no time to learn it, but on the JVSG.com they have a nice manual, so I recommend them as well. If you want to add a camera, here is my camera for example. Of course it's gonna be Bosch camera. Again, I'm going to take the same NDE3502. So this is my Flexidome 3000i. Okay, I use the the previous time I used the bullet camera. So let me switch to NBE. Yeah, here it is. So here we come with the bullet camera. And focal length, we wanted to have 10 millimeters. So it was 10 millimeters. Oh, sorry. And here with the colors, let me disable all these colors and enable this one. You also see the red would be identification zone. Okay, I wanted 10. So the red is the identification zone, yellow is recognition, light green is observation, and if we go farther, you see that it's also the detection. And basically, it corresponds with what the lens calculator says, but also provides you with a nice three-dimensional overview of what actually we're seeing. So see, here is the representation what we see. Okay. Now if I place the camera, because it was behind the fence, so the view was obscured. And now you can see, that you can make nice designs with it. It generates very nice reports, giving you a great overview how a simulation, how actually your project is going to look like and how cameras are going to perform and making a good impression on your customer. This is unfortunately the third party tool. We don't distribute it as Bosch. We cannot offer it to you now, but there are some rumors that we're gonna have together with JVSG our own tool, limited just to Bosch cameras, but then for free and providing all the other functionality. So most of the time I'm mixing this JVSG tool with the lens calculator. What JVSG is not providing me with is, for a time being, we don't have effective video analytics ranges. So I'm using JVSG for design, and then knowing, for example, that this camera, where is it? Let me come back to Dinion 3000i. Sorry, Dinion 3000i, here it is, and we knew it was a 10, so we knew that our video analytics was working up to 56 meters away. So then I will limit my range by 56 meters, and I know, okay, here is all, what the camera sees, and also this is how far the analytics will go. Last two tools for today. This is going to be here. So it's interactive PDF allowing you to select the proper accessories for your camera. Luckily, I have it as well. This is here. It asks you to go into the full screen mode. And basically, okay, let me imagine that I would like that I'd like to have Flexidome 4000. By the way, 3000 series is not in this tool, but it's gonna be exactly the same accessories for 4000 and 3000 series. And that I would like to have it mounted on the pipe. Oh, sorry, on the pole. Then, okay, this is what I need. Here's the camera type number. Here's the pendant interface plate, which we need. Wall mount and the pole mount. And you can, okay, I take the Autodome 5000 I, which we actually, let me have IR. And then I would like to have it, yeah. Let us say on the parapet, this is what we need, the type numbers you have. Where is my presentation? Over here. And last tool to present today is exactly the same like previously, but dedicated for the MIG series cameras, as they have very unique accessories. So here is the MIG tool. It starts with the color and the type numbers here. Let me say that I would like to have a gray one. Okay, here is my camera. And I would like to go pole mount. Here are the options. So these are my accessories, which I need in gray color to match the camera color. All of them listed. With that said, thank you very much for your attention, and I'm giving the place to Patrick. Thank you.
Thank you, Simon, for explaining those video design tools. Let us now have a look on the access control and BIS design tools which we have available. First of all, I want to explain to you the access control product overview. In another webinar, I have explained the full portfolio of Bosch with the hardware which we have in the software possibilities. To have a quick overview, at Bosch we have created a PDF style of document. And this document is explaining all the key components of an access control system of Bosch. So using this document, you can very quickly find back what is the type of controller, what type of reader, what is the compatibility, what kind of software and features do we have. So let us have a look to this document. So it starts in general with the general challenges of today, where to use it, these systems, what kind of verticals and industries to use it. And then the first concrete example is with the software. Which packages do we have? The Access Professional Edition, the Access Management System, and of course the Access Engine of the Building Integration System. And with all the key features which are in. Then we have some functionality at a glance, so that are more the key features which we have inside of this software. Up to the latest one, the threat level management. Then an example is given of a small system using AMS with the AMCs and readers, and a small bill of material is created here to get a little bit of an idea how to put together a BOM. Then the software licenses for each package, APE, AMS, BIS Access Engine, what are the basic packages, but also what are the possible extensions and of course the type numbers for these items. Then the hardware, the Access Modeler Controller, and the readers. So the readers, first of all, the 125 kilohertz lasers, which we usually use for low-end applications. And most of the time we are offering the smart card readers with Wigand, with iClass, or the multi-class OSDP serial readers, which we have in our portfolio with the Lectus Duo, but also the Lectus Secure reader. And the biometric reader, the fingerprint reader, which we have in our portfolio, which is fully integrated to our software. A short overview with the key features. The credentials, which are compatible with the readers which we offer. And the compatibility matrix, which reader is compatible with what kind of card format. So a quick overview, okay, I can use that reader for that type of format. And at the end, the controllers. The controller family, with the 2-door, the 4-door Wigand controller and the 8-door serial controller. And the extension units, which you can connect to these. And at the end, we have the enclosures to mount the controllers in. And the door peripherals, like request to exit buttons and request to exit pairs, which we sometimes forget, which is a really nice device to add on. And if you want to have a training, where you could get it from. So it's a really nice document, compact, to be used when you're making an access control design, to just have it as a reference, what are the components, what to use. Then we switch over to BIS, the BIS System Design Guide. And of course, BIS is a certified product, especially the engineers who need to configure it, they are trained, needs to be certified. But of course, all those pre-design engineers, like also myself as a solution consultant, you also need to know upfront the project, upfront that you are licensed or certified, how to put the BIS system together. And of course, we can assist with that, but we also have a system design guide for that to help you a little bit. This system design guide is showing the main components of a system, the servers, what type of hardware to use, and at the end also the components of BIS and what it is necessary to put together. Starting with the BIS logon server. What are the specifications for the server? How many clients can you have? How is it with the logbooks? How many MACs can I handle from that? So all nice information when you're making your design. When you have a multi-server topology, you know, how many hierarchy levels and how many local providers and central consumers can you have? How many events can I handle in these cases? What kind of hardware to use for your server? And the database server for larger projects, when you're separating the database from the BIS server. And what are then the recommendations around? What kind of hardware to use for that at minimum? Connection servers, if you have to work with that. Sometimes the limitation of an OPC is overdone, and then you need to install a second OPC server. You need to have then a second computer, a connection server, as we call it, to install that OPC server. What are the requirements? What is the performance? The MAX, as we use in our access control, as an extra sustainability level, redundancy level in the system. What are the minimum requirements? What is the hardware for that? And then we get an overview of the BIS system as it is. The alarms, which is giving the commands, which it can do, and of course all the hardware, which is connecting via OPC servers. Individual OPC servers, as explained over here, so that each component has its own OPC server with its own specification and its own features. How many of these OPC servers can I connect to a server? How many addresses, specifically for the automation engine, can I handle? And events, how many events can it handle combined over all these OPC servers? Good information to know. The workstations, the clients, information, how to handle it. And at the end, BIS is working with AutoCAD format for the floor plans as a basis. What to do there, what are the general rules in a nutshell. Then we come to the engines of BIS. BIS has several engines, the automation engine to connect most of the devices like fire, intrusion, PA, third party, BVMS, then the automation engine is required, the video engine, and also the access engine, of course. Let us quickly take the example of the automation engine. Here you see the limitations, so how many addresses for the automation engine itself, the logbook size forward, how many addresses per bus server you can use is all quickly shown. But mainly, it is also given per Bosch component. Of course, also third-party can be connected, but we are focusing here on the Bosch components. It is explained, for example, to start with the map 5000. Okay, I have a map. The OPC server is running on the BIS login server. This one is communicating via the OPC. How many panels can I handle with one OPC server? Then we have the UVZ, the 2000 end of life, but sometimes we need to integrate with all the systems already in place to be compatible. FPA system, OPC. 1 to 31 panels you can connect to one OPC, and if you have more than 31 panels, then you need to install this connection server, the second OPC server, which is then running on another computer and having communication with the BIS. And this is all explained in this document per type of component. And this will continue like that. Then we have another type of document where it was here more about the performance, what to use, how to set together, what are limitations, what are possibilities. We also do have a BIS licensing guide. And the licensing guide is more or less the same type of PDF document, the same structure. You can see also the explanation, operator level, system level, which we have, but it is focusing a bit more on the licenses. Here the BIS license package is explained, the access engine, video engine and the large automation engine, and what can be connected overall. Of course, the BIS structure, how it works, and the BIS licenses. So where the other one was more on limitations and possibilities, this one is going to explain the same per engine, as you can see, same as the other document, but here we are going to focus more on the licenses. So that for this connection to a map 5000 to start again with, that you need a basic package. Okay, also limitations are still put here, how many panels per OPC server. But also, you know, for detector points, which license type do I need for that? And that we do for all of the devices. And the difficulty, to at least my personal experience, especially in the past, was to estimate how many of detector points do I need to reserve, do I need to license to connect all these devices to a BIS system. And for that I want to introduce you to the last tool which we have. It is a simple Excel tool which is helping you with calculating the detector points for the automation engine especially. Let us have a look. I'm opening up now the Excel tool. And then we start with the information, general information of the project. I'm just going to fill in some random data here. And then you can click on start. If you don't like this user interface, you could also go manually to the second page of the report tab. But let us click on the button. Then you get also this user interface for that. And then you see that we have the several type of devices over here, which can be connected to your system. The map, the BG series, the FPA 12 and 5000, which is a small typo as you can see. The Presidio, the Paviro, all kind of Bosch systems and video devices which you can connect like the DIP units. And at the end, DIVARS also. So let us select, let's say, the FPA system. And then I say, yes, I know my system. Installation, I have one panel. I have one remote keypad. And I have around 700 detectors. And I have around 100 output sounders. I have around 100 manual call points. And maybe it does not make sense. I'm not a detailed fire expert, but we have around 20 loops. And this we can do, of course, for each of the single systems. Let's also take a map system. 1, 4 areas, 3 keypads, 50 detectors, 30 models, two loops, and we have 30, let's say, outputs. Now, if we have that all filled in, those key parameters, which is important for the BIS, and also there we help you with now with this simple tool to identify what are the important parameters, because if we take a Presidio system, it's not that you're going to calculate the speakers. Now, with Presidio, we need to know how many devices without a speaker do you have. So call stations, amplifiers, let's say I have five. And then they ask you the zones. So if you have a building with 9 floors and maybe with 900 speakers, but it are 9 zones, yeah, then you don't fill 900 speakers, but 9 zones over here. How many call station items do you have? Let's say we have 3 in this building. Well, and then we are going to calculate it, show report. Will take a little bit of time, as you can see, switching over to the results page. Let us give it the time to calculate. And there we go. Then we see, of course, the project information which was filled in. It's just the second tab, simple tab of this simple tool. And then you see the numbers for going to be filled in and the detector points which it has calculated for that. And then at the end, it does say the total minus 500, because the BIS Automation Engine Basic Package comes with an included 500 detector points. So that means that on top of these 500 for free, you still need to order 800. And the system automatically steps over on the most economical choice. So it will go directly to one package of 1000 detector points and not 8 times 100. It makes automatically the step. You would say, yeah, but it's not so difficult, Patrick. I can do it also manually. Of course, that is possible. But the difficulty with BIS is what is calculated, especially for those panels, for a BG series panel and for an FBA panel. Because if we count here the numbers, then we don't get to 1120. And that is because, let us show the data behind, an FPA panel is already 100 detector points. A BG series panel is 30 detector points. And an area of a BG series area of is 30 detector points. So it's not just straightforward sometimes that one item is also one detector point. So that is why this tool is so good to use for, that you don't have to make these manual calculations for it. It will do it for you. Yeah, and this tool, of course, is already to you offered together with the rest of the information, like the other tools, after the webinar. So this is the last tool what I wanted to show. I'm not going to save this. The Detector Points License Creator. So we have tools for access control, showing you an overview. We had a system design tool for BIS, telling you the overall pictures. What are the servers to use? What are the possibilities? What are the limitations? Then, of course, a design guide for the licenses, which licenses to use, and really specifically for the automation engine, a tool to calculate really what is necessary. And then, of course, the output I did not show, but you can, of course, make a PDF out of it, or just save that into your project folder, that always, you know, this is the calculation which I have made, and for future use, also to show to a customer, listen, this is a fair calculation of the detector points which we need for your installation. With that, I'm going to end this webinar. I want to thank you for joining this webinar, and who knows, see you next time at another webinar or event. Thank you very much.